to a fresh episode of Legal Wrangle, where we will track major judicial developments taken place in the last few weeks in the world of international taxation. For this, we have selected three important cases, one from the domain of TDS on FTS, second from the domain of DTAAs on freight income, and third one from the domain of Section 9(1) on income arising from the property in India. The shipping companies are back in the news in the arena of international taxation laws, obviously again on the settled laws. The Apex Court has time and again clarified that common facility provided to agents for efficient completion of shipping business would not come within the purview of technical services. Let's understand what exactly happened in this decision. The assessing officer in this case has treated the telecommunication facility provided by the AP Moller Maersk AS shipping company to its clearing agents as technical service and hence taxed the payment made by the agents on pro rata basis under the cost sharing arrangement as FTS. When the matter reached High Court, it was held that communication system used by the agents of assessee entailed certain costs reimbursement. It was the part of the shipping business and cannot be captured under the provisions of Income Tax Act except under DTAA. Now let's see what Supreme Court finally decided. The first major ground was payment by the agents. The Apex Court observed that the payments were in nature of reimbursement of cost whereby the agents paid their proportionate share of expenses incurred on the communication systems and this reimbursement was accepted as such at arm's length by the TPO. Therefore, once the character of the payment is found to be in the nature of reimbursement of expenses, it cannot be income chargeable to tax. The second and the most interesting ground was freight income. The Apex Court noted that the revenue itself has given the benefit of Indo-Danish DTAA to assessee by accepting that under Article 9 thereof, freight income is not chargeable to tax as it arises from the operation of ships in the international waters. Once that, it accepted and it was found that the Maersk net system is an integral part of the shipping business without which business cannot be conducted. The use of such facility by agents for discharging their role more effectively cannot be treated as any technical service. In such a situation, profit from operation of ships under Article 19 of DTAA would necessarily include expenses for earning that income and cannot be separated. More so when it is found that the business cannot be run without these expenses. Before we part from this decision, let's quickly understand what were the key takeaways. Income generated from the use of a common facility given by a shipping company to its agent is not fees for technical services if such facility was an integral part of the company's business. Payments made under the cost-sharing arrangement, once accepted as reimbursement, it cannot be charged to tax. Now let's move on to our second case where special bench was formed to decide the rate of tax payable by non-residents in case of their failure to furnish PANs when the TDS was deducted from the payments as per Section 195(1). The assessee, that is Nagarjuna Fertilizers during the subject year, had made payments to non-residents after deducting the tax at lower rates as prescribed in the relevant DTAAs, even when the payees had not furnished valid PAN. Accordingly, the assessee was issued intimations under Section 200A, treating it to be in default for short deduction of TDS by observing that the Section 206A is overriding provision and there was no escape for the assessee except to co-deduct his PAN or to deduct tax at source at 20%. Here is the final verdict of the special bench. Non-resident persons to whom FTS was paid were liable to tax in India at the rates prescribed in the relevant DTAAs. Assessee cannot be held liable to deduct TDS at higher rate by the virtue of Section 206AA as a result of failure of non-resident payees to furnish to their PANs when he has deducted TDS from the payments as per Section 195(1) are the rates adopted being enforced with the meaning of Section 237A. Provisions of Section 206AA are required to be read down so as to make it inapplicable in the cases of concerned non-resident payees who were not under an obligation to obtain PAN. Provisions of Section 206AA, despite the non-obstante clause contained therein, cannot override the provisions of DTAA to the extent that they are more beneficial to the assessee. It is the beneficial provision of the treaty that will override the machinery provisions of the Section 206AA. Now let's move to our last case, where the entire shareholding of Cairn India Holdings Ltd CIHL was acquired by Cairn India Ltd CIL, and the entire receipt was disclosed in the annual financial statement under the head Investments. During assessment, the revenue department observed that the entire business operations of CIHL was located in India, and accordingly, whatever value was derived by CIL was solely from the assets located in India. Therefore, in accordance with the provision of Section 9(1) of IT Act, it shall be deemed to have been situated in India, and consequently, any capital gain arising from the transfer of such shares are chargeable to tax under Indian Income Tax Act. The department further go on to hold that on transfer of shares of CIHL from the assessee, that is Cairn UK Holdings Ltd, to Cairn India Ltd, entire control of oil and gas business of Cairn Group in the India was transferred from assessee to Cairn India Ltd. Therefore, the liability to pay capital gains tax in India arises. Now, let's see what Income Tax Appellate Tribunal had decided. The series of transactions entered into by the Cairn Group culminated into initial public offering of 9.8 crore shares at the rate 160 rupees per share of CIL. In the IPO, CIL had divested 30.5% of the stake to the general public and institutional investors. The complete financial arrangement of the group has ended through series of transfer of shares from UK jurisdictions to Jersey jurisdiction to India. On divesting 30% stake in these oil and gas assets located in India and a part of IPO proceedings, approximately 6100 crore paid to the Cairn Group UK Holdings Ltd. Therefore, these series of transactions entered into by the group is not merely a business reorganization process. Thus, income arising through or from any property in India is chargeable to tax as income deemed to accrue or arise in India in terms of provision of Section 9 of Income Tax Act. Key takeaways are, right of management and control of a company is the property as per provision of Section 2 of Income Tax Act. When a non-resident entity undertakes a business restructuring plan and transfers shares to its group companies and also unlocks the value of the holdings through IPO, it will automatically lead to an increase in the wealth of such entity. When any asset is transferred in lieu of another asset and no specific amount for consideration is agreed between the parties, it has to be construed as transferred by the way of exchange and no capital gain liability arises. Since capital gains for the transaction will be computed by applying fair market value, constitutional cost of acquisition of shares of Indian holding company should also be deemed to be fair market value of its share. While interpreting the provisions of DTAA, the domestic law cannot be presumed as static for determining the taxability of a particular income. With this, we wrap up this episode of Legal Wrangle. Next time, we'll bring you some interesting cases from the world of excise and customs. Keep watching TIOL Tube for our upcoming education video series Learning Curve on the subject GAR and how it affects us all. Thank you for watching.